Hi, I'm Mike Overly. This is Guitar Forum 2.0. I'm the author of Guitar Encyclopedia and Bass Encyclopedia, so we'll have to say that tonight, since tonight's show is actually about bass, and the title of tonight's show is Bass Tone Rows. Now, the first thing that we'd like to do, we got lots to do tonight and play tonight, so I'm going to really push through this show, so bear with me, and I hope you enjoy it. So the first thing we'll start with is that tone rows actually are like short phrases of music, usually one bar, no more than two, and they just loop around. And that makes tone rows different than melodies, because melodies are generally longer, eight bars or more, and actually melodies end. So the difference between a melody and a tone row is tone rows loop and melodies end. So tonight's show is about bass tone rows, and these tone rows are then going to be applied to lots of pop hits over the years, and we'll see what makes bass work on those pop tunes. Okay, so the next thing that we want to do is just sketch out where the tone numbers are. So if we were in four string bass, fret 5, then we have A, and now we're going to say what the tone numbers are, the scale degree numbers. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. And as a general thought, tone rows don't really go past 8, so that'll cover us. Now, they can have altered sharp and flat tone numbers. So if we have a 5, we could have a flat 5. If we have a 7, we could have a flat 7, a tone 4, a sharp 4, stuff like that. So tone rows are now what we're going to apply to songs. So we're going to start with Rock Around the Clock. That was Bill Haley in 1955. Now, the beginning of the tone row, and the simplest, is just playing these one-to-one rhythm ratio. Now, rhythm is all about, if we say it's a one-to-one ratio, then that means we have one beat and we have one note on that one beat, and that would be in value 4, that would be a quarter note. So 4 beats, meter 4 of 4 beats with these 4 tones, 1 and 3 and 5 and 3. So that would create the one bar tone row of 4 beats, 1, 3, 5, 3, which is recognizable as some early, like we're saying, early rock thing. Now we can add one change, a tone number on that, and make it be 1, 3, 5, 6. And that's a development, let's say, of that particular tone row. Instead of 1, 3, 5, 3, it's now going 1, 3, 5, 6. Now, in the Rock Around the Clock tone row, it's a two-bar tone row. And that two-bar tone row then is 1, 3, 5, 6, and then it plays 8, 6, 5, 3. So 1, 3, 5, 6, 8, 6, 5, 3. And now we'll apply that to the last part of this idea is you take the tone row and then you apply it to a harmony progression. Now, harmony progression is symbolized by numerals, and the bonus part of numerals, harmony numerals, is that they're in the same place the tone numbers are. So this could then be said as being harmony numeral 1, harmony numeral 4, and harmony numeral 5. And then those numerals are placed in a progression. One numeral follows another, and the particular progression of Rock Around the Clock is 1 for 4, 4 for 2, 1 for 2, 5 for 2, and 1 for 2. So here's Rock Around the Clock.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're going to rock.
So that's all the time we have to do a particular song. I hope you go to YouTube or wherever you go and listen to the rest of the tune. That was really kind of the beginning of rock music, called Rock Around the Clock, 1955. Now, when we play the harmony progression through one time, we would call that a chorus. So, you know, songs can have many choruses, actually, 8, 16, whatever, as many times as they want to play through the changes, they call it. The harmonic progression is called changes. And that's what creates the length of the song relative to the parts of the song, like choruses and bridges and verses and intros and stuff like that. Okay, now the next tune that we're going to play is, I was using my thumb in those previous tunes, and that thumb gives a more round and smooth sound. And also this bass actually has flat wound strings, which also tends to give it a more smooth sound, like an acoustic bass of those early tunes. So using your thumb gives it a nice smooth sound. On this next tune, I'm going to actually use the pick, called a plectrum, but everybody calls it a pick. And what the pick does, it gives a much more sharper attack to the sound. It's more percussive and it sounds sharper. And therefore, we're going to use the pick on this next song, Night Train, which was a big hit by James Brown in 1962. And once again, that's a one chorus through it. Of course, it would go on and James would dance and everything would be cool. Okay, the next song, now I'm going to change basses and I'm going to play a fretted five-string bass. Now, five-string bass is the most popular bass currently because modern music tended to want to have a lot of low sounds. But in these early tunes, they were all played on four-string basses, but I'm going to go ahead and use this five-string bass because the idea is that a five-string bass is really a four-string bass, so this is E-A-D-G of the four-string E-A-D-G, but it's got an initial fifth string, the low string B, so you can get those extra low sounds. So now I'm going to play a 1989 song, so we're jumping years on this, and this is going to be a Stevie Ray Vaughan song. Now the reason why I'm using a five-string bass to play this Stevie Ray Vaughan song is because starting with Jimi Hendrix and moving on into Stevie Ray, they would take a six-string guitar that had the sixth string of the guitar tuned to E, like the bass four-string is E, and they would tune down a half-step. They'd tune the whole guitar down a half-step, and therefore the open E string became the open E flat string. So therefore, on having to retune the bass, I can go to the five-string bass and I can play open E, but I can play E on the fifth string, and now I can play E flat one fret lower. So the five-string bass lets me play in the key of E flat without having to retune. So here's Stevie Ray Vaughan, Crossfire. And then, of course, that just goes on and on and on and on, and he keeps playing that same tone row throughout the whole entire verse. Okay, now our next song is 1965. This would be Roy Head. This is a song called Treat Her Right. Now, the idea on this is now we're moving into a different rhythm ratio. This is now a 1-to-2 rhythm ratio, and now that means that we have one beat that has two notes, and then those two notes are called eighth notes, and we count eighth notes 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and. So what really happens is in a four beat, one bar tone row, we now have eight different locations that we can put tones in, and this makes a more complex tone row, even though it's still only one bar of four beats. This is Treat Her Right by Roy Head. We're in the key of G. And we have to move on because we got a lot more tunes to play. So now we're going to take Hound Dog, another Elvis tune, but this time now we're going to introduce the concept of syncopate. Now all the earlier ones were synchronized. Now synchronized means that things move together. So on all the tone roads we've played so far, all the tone numbers and the beats are moving together. Now we're going to start to have a tone row that doesn't move exactly with the beat. In other words, they say it plays off the beat, and that means that you're going to attack a tone on an and count. So these kind of rhythms go, and they're called syncopated when we're uneven and off the beat. Hound Dog has a syncopated rhythm that goes one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and coming in on that and of two, one and two and is what creates that syncopated feeling. And even though this only got three tone numbers in it, we're in the key of C, even though it's got three tone numbers in one, three, and five, it's the syncopated rhythm that makes it happen.
You ain't nothing but a
So even though that's such a simple tone row, it's the fact that it has a syncopated rhythm that makes it, made it be a hit. Hound Dog was a huge hit for Elvis in 1956. Now, going to 1967, Albert King did Cross Cut Saw. This is another syncopated rhythm that attacks the string on the and beat. This is Cross Cut Saw by Albert King. So you can see that it had a quasi Latin beat happening on the drum part that helped pop it forward on the syncopated sound. And in 1967, that Albert King Cross Cut Saw really changed the direction of the way blues went. This next tone row now is moving off into, this is 1964, this is Herbie Hancock. Herbie is known as a jazz player, which he is, of course, but in the early days, he was kind of like a more soulful funk kind of player, and today we might even call that smooth jazz. But now what we have is we have a tone row that's another syncopated tone row, but what's different about this particular harmony progression is that it just doesn't follow the 1-4-5 type of traditional rock changes. It has a much more stretched out, which really created the feeling of smooth jazz, like of what we would call modal music, which changed the face of music post 59 with Miles, and Herbie played with Miles and stuff like that. Anyway, here's Cantaloupe Island. We're in the key of F minor. So you can hear on that one, it's a very, very different feel. It's all stretched out. The harmony is much more elongated and just doesn't move in a rock-like fashion. Another syncopated tone row, though. And now we have another. Is that true? Nope. Two pages at once, stuck together here. Okay, here we go. Now we have Ray Charles. Now this is 1959. Huge hit for Ray with a song called What I Say. Now this is a two-bar tone row. Now what makes this two-bar tone row way more syncopated than everything else is that it's actually using what we call a tie in music. A tie is a curved line that connects sound, and in other words makes sound sustain. And when you, in this particular two-bar tone row, they have an anticipation, which means to play before the next harmony is really arrived at, in other words, the next beat. So he's playing on the and of four on the first bar and tying over, sustaining into beat one. And that tying across the bar really creates the most feeling of off the beat that syncopated music has. And this then is What I Say by Ray Charles in the key of E. Also, this is a live track, which is makes it more fun. Ray playing his organ there. It's hard to stop on that tune, man. That one's got the coolest groove of the tone rows on a two-bar tone row. Okay, next is Watermelon Man. Now, Watermelon Man is another two-bar tone row that also ties across the bar and creates a syncopation. But Watermelon Man is more into that not so much rock gospel kind of feel that the What I Say was. It's more into what Herbie was doing. This is 1962 in the kind of modal smooth thing. This is in the key of F. Oh, wait. The one thing that's important about this tone row is that we can play sounds, tones that are lower than one. If we go to A on the fourth string of a five string bass, then there's tone one and its octave is tone eight. Tone eight going down a half step is tone seven. So if we play tone one, we can go down a half step and we would call that underline seven. And underline tone numbers are lower than one. So we have an underline seven in this particular tone row. And this is the only row that has tone numbers that go lower than one, and that's kind of actually unusual. So here's a Watermelon Man. Not yet. Hugh Masekela also had a big hit with that. He was a trumpet player, African, from Africa, trumpet player, and he had a big hit with Watermelon Man also. Okay, now we're going to play that thing we just heard, the Crossroads Cream song, Eric Clapton. A much faster riff, another syncopated tone row. Riff, I just said, bass riffs. I'm calling it bass tone rows because I want to get into the tone number concept. But actually, most people call these bass patterns that I'm playing, they call them bass riffs. Now, riff is really a subjective term. But basically, there's a difference between riffs and licks that I make, that riffs are repeated low tones. That's why we're calling them bass riffs, bass tone rows, because they're looping. And licks, which we don't really play on the bass, and licks are high sounds, repeated things. So generally speaking, what we're saying is riffs are low and licks are high, and therefore these are bass riffs or bass tone rows. And now we got a Crossroads in the key of A. Of course, Cream and rock and everything gets much more energy, and if you were playing all night long, you'd be all warmed up and ready to go. It's a little cool here in the studio tonight. Anyway, that was 1968, that was Crossroads. Okay, now we're moving into 62 here. This is Booker T and the MGs. They had a huge hit with a song called Green Onions. And now what we have next is a different rhythm ratio. This rhythm ratio is a 1-to-3 rhythm ratio. What that means now is that we have one beat that has three parts. And these three parts are called triplets. And we count them 1 triplet, 2 triplet. So triplets are three parts to one beat. Now, when we only play the first part and the last part of the triplet, that's actually called a shuffle rhythm. And therefore, when we have a rhythm that goes 1 triplet, 2 triplet, 3 triplet, 4 triplet, 1 triplet, 2, that uneven feeling, that's called shuffle. And that's what this Green Onions is. It's a shuffle rhythm in the key of F. Now, one thing I'd like to do on that particular song, because I forgot to do it earlier, so let's do it now, and that is that the third way of playing the bass, and what I just did play on the earlier ones, I played with the thumb, because I said that gave that round sound. Then we played with the pick, and that gives it a much more percussive attack and much more sharp. And now the third way of playing the bass is with the right hand fingers themselves. And therefore now we call I and M, simply stated for everybody, index and middle. And then we just alternate that and we get this I, M, I, M, I, M, I, M. And what that really is, that's kind of the middle of both of those things. It doesn't sound as round as the thumb and it doesn't sound as sharp as the pick. It's kind of in the middle, so it sounds like round sharp, whatever that would be. So playing with your fingers, and you'll see lots and lots of bass players play with their fingers. That's kind of the more, and of course, orchestrally, the acoustic bass, that's what they play with all the time, their fingers. Sometimes they use a thumb, but that's very rare. They play with their fingers. They never use a pick in the orchestra. So I'm going to play that Green Onions a little bit with my fingers, and just to listen to the difference of the tone. And of course, Duck Dunn, who was the bass player that played with Booker T and the MGs, he used his fingers, but it was on a four-string bass. I just hadn't switched back to the four-string because we just want to play through our tunes tonight. Okay, now we're going to move to a Freddie King song called Hideaway, but we're going to play it by, we're going to play the harmony progression and the tone row that Eric Clapton played with Cream when he did Hideaway. So here's Hideaway in the key of E. And one last tone row here to go in tonight's show, and this is a Miles Davis tune, All Blues, and I'm going to shift over to the fretless bass. Now this is another five-string bass, but it's fretless. Now the fretless bass has an entirely different sound than everything else, because it doesn't have any frets, and it just glides along. And sounds the most like an acoustic bass. And for this All Blues Songs of Miles Davis in 1959 from the Kind of Blue album, this would sound the most characteristic of what this particular tune is. So this is All Blues, Miles Davis, 59, in the key of G. Thank you. And that is tonight's show. I hope you enjoyed those tone rows and that blast through all that music. And I will leave you with wishing you the best of all good things, and I'll meet you here next time. Have fun.